I am Drew. In this video, we're going to do four examples of finding limits of piecewise functions. Why four? Because, well, they're a bit more complicated. Here's our first example. We want to find the limit as x approaches 1 of f of x, where f of x is defined as x plus 1, where x is less than 1, and 5x minus 3, where x is greater than 1. If my piecewise function is defined like this, with just x being defined where x is less than 1 and greater than 1, we would have a function that consists of basically two separate lines coming together to make the single piecewise function, and there's a hole where x equals 1, because this function is for when x is less than 1, and this function is this piece of the function is for where x is greater than 1. If I come through here and I do greater than or equal to, well, now my hole is going to be filled in. However, either way, this example was going to have the same answer for the limit, because a limit is going to express, you know, as x approaches a, the function's value approaches something. So even if the function is undefined at x equals 1 and there's a hole there, even though we can see graphically the graph is approaching, let's see, as we let a approach 1 from the left, we're approaching a y value if it's supposed to be 2. And as we approach the a value of 1 from the right, the y value is also approaching 2. So as we approach from the left and the right, we're approaching the same y value. So thus, if the left and right limit exists, and remember, again, then the two-sided limit, and there's no plus or minus written here, so that's what this is, does exist. And we don't actually have to have a function, our function defined at that point, to be able to find a limit. So let's just take that out just to reemphasize that point. That's supposed to be now empty. Get back to the original example. Well, with piecewise functions, I just did a video with, I think it was like six examples of finding limits using properties. And we were just able to take the value of a and plug them in. And if that value of a made the denominator undefined, maybe we did a little cancellation to make the fraction or the quotient, you know, appear different and therefore work for that given value of a. Well, piecewise functions, they're literally, you know, multiple functions put together to make a single graph or you know, function, piecewise function. So there's often different behavior on the left and right hand side of these values of a. And these values of a that they're going to ask you to test the limits at are generally going to be where the piecewise function sort of shifts gears, changes gears between one function to the other, because that's where usually our biggest issue is finding limits. You know, and they don't have to make that match, but they generally will. So because we have a function x plus 1 working on the left side of 1 and a function 5x minus 3 working on the right side value of 1, when you find limits of piecewise functions, you must always check the limit as x approaches a from the left and the right separately and make sure that those two one-sided limits match so that there actually is a limit. Okay, enough of the introduction, let's get these four examples done. The limit as x approaches 1 from the left, well, when you're approaching 1 from the left, your x values are smaller or less than, so we're using the x values that are less than 1. Well, but it's infinitely close to 1 from the left, so I don't want to put in, you know, I don't want to put in, we're going to use the first function because that's where x is less than 1, or we use that first piece when x is less than 1. I don't want to put in point, you know, a limit is letting x approach infinitely close to a. So while this, you know, I'm going to put 1 into my work, but this notation right here says that we're letting x approach 1 from the left. So, you know, really technically this is like point, but it's just not quite. It's infinitely close to 1, but it's on the left. So we're using that first function, but I'm not going to write a bunch of 9s. I'm writing 1. You know, it's a limit. So this comes out to be 2. So our left-hand limit is equal to 2, our left limit. As we let x approach 1 from the right, well, if I'm to the right of 1, even if it's 1.0001, it's still bigger than 1. So if I'm using x values that are greater than 1, even just infinitely greater or minusculely greater, that's going to be using the second function. So I'm going to take the value of 1 now and plug it into the second piece of my piecewise function and get 5 times 1 minus 3. Well, that also comes out to be 2. So as I approach 1 from the left, I get a value of 2. As I approach 1 from the right, I get a value of 2. I can see that with my picture, which you won't necessarily be given in the textbook. We're supposed to be learning how to do these with properties. We talked about, you know, finding limits using graphs a couple of sections ago. Our left and right hand limit is equal, so thus the limit as x approaches 1 of f of x is 2. So my left and right hand limit are equal. I got 3 more examples. Second example, piecewise function. With this piecewise function, the first piece is defined everywhere except x equals 5, and that is being excluded. We can clearly see here, if we take 5 and plug it in, this first piece of the function becomes undefined. So at x equals 5, the function is defined as having a value of 7. So let's find the limit as x approaches 5 from the left. Well, if you're approaching 5 from the left, then x is not exactly equal to 5, even though that's what I'm going to plug into my expression. This says that it's not really 5, but just a hair less. So I'm not using the second piece of the function, I'm using the first one. So we're finding the limit as x approaches 5 from the left of 3x squared minus 75 over x minus 5. Well, we have an issue with this because if we plug in 5, this becomes undefined. So hopefully the top cancels out and we're able to get rid of that x minus 5 relatively easily. So this becomes the limit as x approaches 5 from the left. Well, I'm going to do a little scratch work here on the side just to save a little bit of writing time. This 3x squared minus 75, both of these terms have a factor of 3, so we're going to factor that out and get 3 times x squared minus 25, and this is a difference of squares, so we're going to be able to factor that difference of squares and get 3 times x plus 5 times x minus 5 over x minus 5, and that common factor of 3x, or excuse me, x minus 5 is getting canceled out. So what we have left is the limit as x approaches 5 from the left of, let's go ahead and distribute this, 3x plus 15. And if you were to graph this, you would see that it was, you know, what's left is a line. This is mx plus b, f of x equals mx plus b. This is a line with a slope of 3 and a y-intercept of 15. But that line is going to have a hole at the x value of 5. And the graph is probably, this is going to approach the hole from the same, approach the same limit, the same y value from both the left and the right. So we're going to take the value of negative 5, or excuse me, I saw that, it said negative. We're going to take this x value 5, we're going to let x approach 5 from the left, plug into the expression. Three times 5 is 15, and 15 plus 15 is 30. And that is our limit as we approach 5 from the left. Now, we need to make sure that the left and right hand limit are equal. And I do have to show this work, except we really can't see if we're not using the exact same value of 5, the exact value of 5, if we're letting the value of a approach 5, and so therefore it's not equal to 5. We're going to be using the same function to find the left and the right hand limits, so they're going to be equal, but we need to show that work to let, you know, our teacher know that we understand with the piecewise function, we got to do the left and the right. So the limit as x approaches 5 from the right is going to, of, you know, the same reduced 3x plus 15 is going to be once again equal to 30. So since the left and the right hand limit are equal, the two-sided limit, the limit as x approaches 5, I'm running out of room here, of f of x, notice I'm writing f of x the name of the piecewise function, because I am finding the limit of this entire function, not just the first piece of it, is equal to, what do we have again? Our left and right hand limits were 30. Now, the actual function's value at 5 is 7. So we have a line with a hole in it. That hole is undefined. Well, actually, it is defined, excuse me, but its value, it's basically going to be like a line with a hole in it. And then way down here, the limit's equal to 30, so the line's coming together at a y value of 30, but there's going to be a dot down there at 5, comma, 7. You know, that dot that, well, you know, it'd be nice if it was in the hole to make the line continuous and smooth and whatever, but it wasn't. So let's do another example. Bam! For our third example, we have the limit as x approaches 3 of f of x, where the first piece is negative 1/4 x plus 4, where x is less than 3. F of x is equal to 1, where x is equal to 3. And then finally, x minus 3 squared, where x is greater than 3. I've included the picture as a teaching tool. You would not be given this again while you're doing your homework in the section of your book, probably, where you're finding these using properties of limits. I just want to let you see what's going on. The first function is this white line, open dot, at x equals 3. Then when x is exactly equal to 3, we have a closed dot here at a y value of 1. And then finally, we have basically, we have a parabola whose vertex is at 3, 0, and it is defined for x values that are greater than 3. So we're not going to actually be able to find a limit for this, because the left and right hand limits are not equal. But we're not, you know, doing limits with the graphical method. We're doing it algebraically. So when not given this, how do you find the limit for this piecewise function? Well, you need to find, like we just did before the other two, the limit as x approaches 3 from the left. If you're approaching 3 from the left, your y values, or excuse me, your x values are, you know, less than 3, even though they're becoming infinitely close, you know, like 2.99. So if we're using x values are less than 3, we're supposed to use the first piece of this piecewise function. So we have negative 1/4 times 3 plus 4. And, you know, this is a polynomial. We can just plug it in. We get, let's see here. Negative 3/4 plus 4. And, well, if you want to show all the steps, we need common denominators. So let's multiply top and bottom by 4. It's kind of bugging me. I probably should have wrote here negative 1/4 x plus 4 and then plugged in the 3 to find the limit. So I'm not, probably not looking at my notation there a little bit. So we have negative 3 over 4 plus 16 over 4. And 16 minus 3 is equal to 13 over 4. And 13 over 4, there's, let's see here. There's 3 4s and 13, leaving you the remainder of 1, because 3 times 4 is 12. So this becomes 3 and 1/4, which you very well could have known in your head, you know, just by saying, okay, if I take 3 quarters away from 4, I do get 3 and a quarter. You don't necessarily have to be showing the work of how to add fractions. I just did that in case you're struggling with it. As you let the limit as x approaches 3 from the right, well, now if you approach 3 from the right, you're using x values that are bigger than 3, even if they are just, you know, minusculely larger than 3, like just a hair over, just a tiny bit over 3, but it's not 3. So we're using x values that are greater than 3 if we approach from the right, so this value of 3 becomes, well, 3 minus 3 squared, that's negative 3 minus 3, which is 0, and 0 squared is 0. And we do get, you know, these y values, these limits that we were expecting from the graph. As we approach the value of 3 from the left, our limit is 3 and a quarter. It doesn't show up in a picture. It looks like it was 3. But we were looking at a left-hand limit of 3 and a quarter. And as we approach the value of 3 from the right, we're approaching a y value of 0. Our left and right-hand limits are different, so the limit as x approaches 3 of f of x does not exist. I'm going to do one more example of a couple of trig functions and a piecewise function and see what that looks like. And that'll be your last example. All right, last example. Thank you very much for watching these videos. I really appreciate it and hope they're helping you guys out. We have the limit of f, the limit as x approaches 0 of f of x, where the first piece is cosine of x defined, where x is less than or equal to 0, and the tangent of x plus 1, where x is greater than 0. We have a basic cosine function over here, which has a period of 2, amplitude of 1, and da-da-da-da-da. And we have the tangent of x plus 1. Now, we have an addition of 1. It's not inside the math function. It's not inside the tangent function, so this plus 1 is a vertical shift. And I've included the graph. Again, you wouldn't need to do the graph to answer this question. I'm just giving you that as a teaching tool. We can see as we approach the x value of 0 from the left using the cosine function, we're approaching a y value of 1. And as we approach the x value from the right, well, we can see that the graph is coming together from the left and the right, and we should be getting a two-sided limit which is equal to 1, or a left limit and a right limit that are both equal to 1, and thus we have a two-sided limit. So let's see if the algebra shows that, and we don't make any mistakes here. So we have, again, limit as x approaches 0, f of x, two pieces. Let's find the limit as x approaches 0 from the left of f of x. We are approaching 0 from the left. That means we're talking about values of 0, x's that are less than 0. So we're going to plug it into the first one. The limit as x approaches 0 from the left of the cosine of x. And that is equal to the cosine of 0, which, let's see, unit circle, 0 radians. Cosine is x over r, or on the unit circle, the cosine is the x value because, you know, it's a unit circle, the radius is equal to 1, and cosine of 0 is 1. So, our left limit is 1. The limit as x approaches 0 from the right of f of x, which is the limit as x approaches 0 from the right again to the right, x's are bigger than 0, x is greater than 0, we plug it into the second function here, the tangent of x plus 1. So let's plug it in and get the tangent of 0 plus 1. Well, tangent of 0. Tangent, the ratio for tangent is y over x. You know, I'm using the sort of like your trig ratios. I know that sine and, you know, SOHCAHTOA, sine's opposite over hypotenuse, cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, tangent's opposite over adjacent. But when you're dealing with trig, you know, trig functions, most of our angles, remember, in trigonometry were had the vertex of the angle on the origin. So that's the ratios of, you know, sine is y over r, sine of theta is y over r, cosine of theta is x over r, tangent of theta is y over x. It's just easier to put it in terms of x and y and r when you are talking about standard position angles. And I'm just sort of assuming that that's what we have here. So the tangent of 0. Again, 0 radians, tangent is y over x, so at 0 radians on the unit circle, the y value is, well, 0, and the x value is 1, so 0 over 1 is equal to 0. So we have the tangent of 0 is 0 plus 1 equals 1. Our left and our right-hand side limits are equal, so thus, left-hand limit, right-hand limit, so the limit, the limit as x approaches 0, forgot what I was doing, of f of x is equal to 1. I'm Mr. True, and that is finding limits of piecewise functions. Bam! Go to your home.